that's what they call you, isn't it, Polly? That's a crazy name for a crazy lawyer.
Thanks for letting me sit in, Pi.
Hey, you're not splitting the scene, man, huh? I mean, you're not cutting out.
No, I'll be back.
Mrs.
Manning's
the lawyer.
Hi. All right. Sit down, won't you?
I'm sorry, I can't let you know. Mrs. Manning, may I talk to you for a moment outside?
Mrs. Manning, I thought we dropped the formalities a long time ago.
I think maybe we'd better pick them up again. It's important.
All right, I'll go with you.
All right, come on.
Hey, you're coming back, aren't you?
Sure, what do you think?
See you later, Maya.
Okay.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Beyond the Bay Live. We are here tonight discussing one of the classic films that we have as part of our Beyond the Bay Live series. And tonight's film is going to be Anatomy of the Murder. It's our live stream Q&A tonight, and hopefully everybody out there had a chance to watch the film. If you haven't seen it, please do after this, and you'll be really, it's a very good movie. So right now, just understand that the Q&A session is being run by the Bay Community Theater. The Bay Community Theater is a nonprofit organization that runs the Bay Theater in Sutton's Bay, Michigan. We're doing this as part of our community outreach to people in the community to help them understand and appreciate cinema. We do this as all volunteers. We're a nonprofit, and we do appreciate any donations we may get for this. And as much as you are spending time with us, we thank you very much, because all of us are also spending our time as well. So thank you very much. Tonight, we have a series of panelists that we'd like to introduce today that are going to be with us. The first one is going to be Kevin Maher. Kevin Maher. Kevin is a industry professional, and he is a has worked for over 20 years at several studios, including Warner Brothers, 20th Century Fox, and Disney. Kevin writes and maintains the film blog site top10filmlist.com. Next, let's introduce, hi, Ted, Kevin, thank you very much. Good to see you. He's also a member of our programming team, and we always appreciate him being there. Next, let's introduce Ted Kroll. Ted Kroll is a film historian who taught film classes at Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut, and helped to establish a movie theater that is still operating today. And today, so thank you very much, Ted, for being here today. We appreciate that. And you do, he's also on our, Ted is also on our programming committee, and he does a lot of work regarding that. Let's next talk and look at our special guest tonight. Our special guest is Jeff Slocombe. Jeff is a private practice attorney practicing criminal and civil litigation. In his practice, Jeff has been involved with 2 murder trials, 5 murder cases, and over 50 capital crimes and hundreds of other felonies. Jeff is a board member of the Bay Community Theater and is currently running for Leelanau County Prosecutor. So thank you very much today, Jeff, for taking the time to be with us. So let's start out today, and I'd like to have how this works, basically. Before we start out, let's just explain a little bit about how this works. How this works is that we will monitor and have the questions that you have. We have a couple questions to start with, but we'll have questions. We'd like you to post them. If you look on the bottom of the screen, some of it's on the bottom of the screen, sometimes other people's on the side of your screen, up and down. It's a chat area. If you could chat in that area and introduce yourself to other people. I see other people. Great to see other people back that we've known and see before here before. So thank you for participating. And if you could chat amongst yourselves as the discussion goes along, it usually gets pretty interesting. But additionally, what we really would like from you is we would like to have questions. So if you could ask questions during this time by putting them into there. We also have our backstage person, White Fang, being able to help us out and to be able to post those questions up for us when we need them. So let's get started. I see we've got some people in the into the audience already, and everything we're seeing everybody from Washington, D.C., in Northport and Sarasota, Florida. So thank you very much. Let's get started tonight with our first question. Our first question is going to be about just a general question, real short for each one of you. We'll start with Ted first. Is that, Ted, why is this film significant to remain a part of film history? You're muted, Ted.
There's so many aspects of this film that makes it a good film. It was very much a big success in its day, and it had a lot of randy elements to it. You know, there were parts to it that, you know, made it an adult drama. But I think where it has lasted is that the acting is so good, the pacing is so good. You have something like the Duke Ellington score, which is a kind of an interesting, unique thing in its day. And then you have the fact that it was filmed out of the studio. The whole thing was done in Northern Michigan, and so there's this realistic look to it that's very different than that something would be made in a Hollywood studio. And in the background, there are all these people, locals that are in it too. So it is one of these movies where all these different elements, and you know, it's got a great story. So where all these elements came together to make a very a film that is that you pay attention to. It's 2.5 hours long, and it every time I've seen it, it seems like it just flies by, and that had a lot to do with all those elements coming together, and it was one of those films made in Hollywood. The studio, well, it wasn't a studio film, but it was one of those few films where, I'm kind of repeating myself. There are all these different elements, but the cast and the all the director and everything just worked so well together, and it's lasted over the. In fact, I think its reputation has grown over the years, so that's part of it.
Well, good. Well, thank you, Ted. Kevin, what do you think why this film should remain a significant part of film history?
Well, for me, it's really about two things. The first of which is the director, Otto Preminger, was one of the preeminent independent producer directors in the 1950s. And the evolution of the producer directors sort of forced the undoing of the classic studio system that had taken place during the 30s and 40s. And early part of the 50s. Preminger was one of the best at creating his own movies and then bringing them to the studio for strictly for distribution rights. The studios generally had no say over the content. And the second thing is the content that Preminger was often pushing in the 50s was content that challenged the production code, which was the draconian censorship, self-censorship that Hollywood agreed to in the mid-30s that really created unrealistic life experiences. And Preminger sought out content that would push the production code. And I think in 1959, with Anatomy of a Murder, this was sort of, you know, kicking down the door once and for all with the subject matter, the language, and the overall tone of the film sort of helping to do away with the production code, which by probably the early to mid 60s was completely gone. So for me, that's those two things make Anatomy of a Murder one of the all time greats.
Mm-hmm. And thank you very much, Kevin. We could talk a lot about one of those topics very much. So thank you. And Jeff, what do you think? Why is this film going to be remade part of film history?
Well, it was so realistic at the time, and it really followed along with what the law was, and obviously followed a very realistic scenario. Behind the person that actually wrote it, actually defended the case. Obviously, there's differences. Certainly, the law is not the same as it is now, and we can talk about that later. But it's realistic. But the emotions that were involved, as far as you know, jealousy, murder, and how realistic it was to be filmed in the UP, which if you figure the way the UP was in the 50s, was a really brave thing to do, which with what the director is known for. So for all those reasons, I mean, it's just it was a very real film then at the time. And we all know of some of the just the really saccharine fake movies of the 50s. This was not like that. It was just true, and the emotions remain true today.
Wow. Well, thank you, everybody. And those points will hopefully trigger some things off in the audience and ask questions about that, because those are all very good examples of why this should be remaining a part of film history. Let's go on to our first question. And remember, people, you can post questions on the bottom. The first question is, irresistible impulse was the defense argument why Mannion was not guilty. Is this a legal reason for being able to commit murder? Any case history in Michigan to support this as indicated in the movie? Jeff, let's go to you first to answer this question. Start the discussion.
Thank you. Certainly this was an actual, you know, they're going through the library and they're searching and searching and searching, and the judge that's actually handling the case comes in and takes a look and looks on approvingly about them burning the midnight oil and finding this rare case from 1886. And it was, and it, as true to the actual case, irresistible impulse was the actual defense that was used. And the jury in that case, in the actual case, was out for 4 hours. And they found him not guilty. That is something that could be used. And today's legal system, there's not this, everything is codified. Everything is very well set. And there really aren't surprises in any trials anymore. For example, if you want to do a diminished capacity, there are many types of diminished capacity, but they're all listed. If you wanted to do a insanity defense, if you wanted to say temporary insanity, permanent insanity, competency to stand trial, competency at the time, you have to give notice right away to the court and the prosecutor that you want to pursue that. And there's, you can't look for some obscure case from the 1800s to help you out with that anymore, because everything, the courts took everything from the past and all the defenses, and they put them into a, they put them into laws that you have to follow. And the things that apply now, there's rules of evidence. The Michigan rules of evidence apply with all trials, civil and criminal. And those didn't exist in the 50s. And the Michigan court rules, now here's a Michigan court rules, those didn't exist until the 80s. And it's really kind of strange, the things we take for granted that, you know, this is what you do. You have to follow these rules. You really can't come up with these obscure cases anymore. And there's also things when you give questions to the jury, to Michigan criminal jury instructions, all these things are listed out. You have to give notice, and there are all sorts of defenses that you can use. But Larry, I don't know if this would be the time to talk about it, but when you are in that case, the guy was found not guilty in the movie. In today's date, if you're found not guilty by reason of insanity or something, some sort of diminished defense, you could be go to a psychiatric hospital forever until you die. Even if the penalty for that crime that you've committed is, say, a 4-year penalty, it doesn't matter until a psychiatrist or some professional says that you are not suffering from that defect anymore. You stay incarcerated or you know, held against your will. And in that original case that took place, he was found guilty, he was held over, and then a psychiatrist 2 days later issued an opinion that said he was competent and he was not suffering from that temporary insanity anymore, this irresistible impulse, and he was released. That wouldn't happen today. Typically, people are, if they are found not guilty by reason of insanity or something similar to that, they're in for a long time.
Thank you, Jeff. That's usually a big question coming out of this film. Kevin, do you have any more discussion on that?
No, I think he laid it out, and I think it is good to know the sort of the direct evolution of the judicial process and how there have been improvements since then. Because, yeah, he certainly skated on this one.
So I'm just going to throw something out, Jeff, just for this conversation a little bit here, is that in consideration of this, since this is a small town, UP and everything else, would this have anything to do with being a small town today? Do people work around the rules?
Well, you know, that was really interesting because the one scene, there's a local judge, he's just retired, Michael Haley, really liked Anatomy of a Murder and did it in a play a number of times. And he had a number of, they used to have the judges come out and they would give this droll presentation to the juries about, you know, your civic responsibility and things like that. And what he would do is he played sections of Anatomy of a Murder for the jury in this little video presentation he made for them. And one of the things he talked about, or one of the things he played, was the discussion that the defense attorney had with the defendant in saying, you know, kind of leading him to this irresistible impulse to vents. And if that were done, and I suppose in reality it might be done, but if that could be proven that that was done, that attorney would very likely lose their license because that was very unethical. And you cannot shoehorn your case into the law. You could try and do it, but if you're coaching your defendant to say something well, this is the law, are you sure that's not what happened? There's professional rules of conduct that didn't exist back then either, that would cause them to be sanctioned.
That's very good to hear. Ted, you had your unmuted. You have something to say?
Yeah, I you know, there's all this legal talk, and sure, that's all implied with the in the story. I mean, it is a big trial kind of thing, but it has more to do with, I think the movie more has to do with personalities. And, you know, the way they switch and who are these people and what are their motives? I mean, it's really interesting to me that the trial really ends with, you know, when George C. Scott is told that, you know, I'm the daughter of this guy. And then that sort of ends the whole trial part of it. And there's none of the closing arguments and any of that kind of thing. So it has more to do with the drama of these participants in it. And, you know, James Stewart is being James Stewart. You kind of think of him as, you know, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, but at the same time, he is a pretty ruthless character when he gets up there. He wants to win this thing. And, you know, his motives are he's not just one. It's a rather complex character he is. And I think that's what makes the movie really substantial, is that he's not just this, you know, when he says, oh, shucks, I'm just a country lawyer, boy, was that a big fib. and it's later mentioned on that too, you know, he really knows what he's doing there. And like you say, he's not the most ethical on the purpose of it, but, you know, he's out there to win a case, and he's enjoying playing George C. Scott and all this stuff. But one other thing I want to point out, and I hope we get to this, is that the judge was played by Joseph Welsh. And Joseph Welsh in 1959 was a personality known to the public there because he was a real-life lawyer in the MacArthur Army hearings. And he's the one that told, and he had the same kind of demeanor in the McCarthy hearings, and he's the one that told off McCarthy, saying, you know, his famous line, I'm not sure if I get it right, but it's like, have you no decency, sir? And that kind of like punctured the balloon of McCarthy. And he really loved playing this judge. He makes this movie special, I think. He was never an actor. He never pretended to be an actor. Apparently one of his stipulations to be in the movie was that his wife would be one of the jury members. So that's a little footnote to this thing. That's my point, though. I mean, the movie is more about personalities than it is about the law. That's my feeling.
Okay. Yeah, I'd agree with that what Ted's just saying, and sort of add to it that I think it's all about performance. Jeff, we touched on this a little bit in the pre-show discussion, that everybody in this film is giving a performance within their performance. Nobody, except for the judge. I think Welch or Preminger had Welch play that straight, and his folksiness came through. But aside from him, there's really none of the other characters are above board throughout the film. They're all putting on some kind of act. I think the interesting thing about Stewart's performance is it does cast back to his earlier sort of Pollyanna-esque persona, but it also reflects what he was doing in the 50s, which was playing a lot more morally ambiguous characters in like Naked Spur and certainly in Vertigo, two of the more well-known of his morally ambiguous characters. But I think you see him taking on and off that act, sort of going back from Jimmy Stewart the actor to Jimmy Stewart the performer, and it's really interesting to watch him sort of unmask himself when he's in the courtroom and then put his Jimmy Stewart mask back on when he's out, having a couple beers with McCarthy and hanging out with his secretary. So I think that's indicative of everybody having a performance. Certainly Mannion is performing in everything he does. That ivory cigarette holder is one of the most absurd things that I see in this movie, because every time he takes it out, I just shake my head. It's like, it's not natural. I think it's about performance as well as the personalities.
Okay. All right. That was pretty good. Thank you, guys. That was a good discussion. Get that going. Do we have any questions from the audience or any other questions next, White Fang? Is this a true story? We've kind of touched on this. Let's go to Ted first. What do you think about this? Was it a true story, and how does this relate to truth? You're muted.
Boy, the movie came from a best-selling novel called Anatomy of a Murderer, though. It was still on the bestseller list when the movie came out. That was part of Preminger rushed this movie so that it wouldn't lose it. So one thing about Preminger was he was a great self-promoter. And that's a lot of part of the reason he chose the subject matter he did. At any rate, the author is called Travers, and it's his writing name of a guy who was actually on the Supreme Court in Michigan, and I keep forgetting his name again. It's Joseph
John Volker.
Oh, John Volker.
Yeah,
and he actually did a case. It was in 1952 in the UP up there. He actually was gotten beaten out by the district attorney, and he was a private attorney, and he took on this case of a guy who, a lieutenant that murdered somebody that was giving his wife a hard time. And it's very, I think he got off on the same charge, the same kind of thing. So basically this, and the film takes place, and all the scenes take place in realistic things of where the story actually took place. James Stewart was his room, his house in the movie is the exact house of this guy, John Volker. That's another amazing thing about this film is it's all, the whole thing was filmed up in the UP in realistic places. There were no sets in this thing. And, That made the photography have this feel about it. It's very different from the most Hollywood films. It's a true story.
So Ted, I just want to sort of layer on that with Welch and then Volker. And once Welch took the job, he actually started a correspondence with Volker that resulted in a long-term friendship between the two. And I thought it was very interesting. And Jeff, maybe you could speak to this. But one of the questions that Welch asked Volker, Welch was an attorney from the East Coast. I think it was around Boston or something. He asked Volker if judges in Michigan wore robes and what type of robes they wore, because he didn't want to look like a stuffed panda in an ill-fitting robe, even if he needed to wear a robe, because he wasn't sure what the custom was in Michigan. Do you know how long the custom has been for, because every courtroom I've been here in the state, they've all had robes on. Is that newer?
Oh yeah, that's one of the things. Thank God we didn't inherit the wigs from England, but we did inherit the robes, and they've been in the, you know, that's been a part of the jurisprudence ever since then. And the way they showed the judges, the judge in the actual real case was a visiting judge from Hillsdale County, who came up to Marquette County, is where it was in real life it all took place. And it was an irresistible impulse defense, and the jury was out for 4 hours, and they came back with a verdict of not guilty by reason of temporary insanity. And 2 days later, they had, the defense attorney got, you know, somebody that he knew to come in and say, yeah, he's fine now. You know, he's just upset at the time. And so he's completely released. As I said, there's no way that would happen today. People just don't walk away from things like this like they did then. But in real life, the guy did walk away. But one thing quickly about the judges, the judges locally, or any judges I've been in front of, they're really good about not showing prejudice to one side or the other. They really try and follow the law, and they really try and run a clean ship. That is the one thing that I found might have been certainly more Hollywood, was that some of the things they said in the trial and the conduct would have warranted a mistrial. And the attorney that did some of these things, like Stewart was doing, and actually like George C. Scott was doing, would have warranted a mistrial and sanctions. So that is the one thing that probably wouldn't have happened.
You know, it's interesting, and I think Ted may have mentioned this before, that Preminger, the director, was actually a trained lawyer from his time in Vienna. His Preminger's father was the attorney general for the Austria-Hungarian Empire in the early part of the 20th century. So he came from a wealthy family. And I think Foster Hirsch, the biographer of Preminger, says that he was probably the only director who could have directed this, because he was a lawyer directing a movie about a trial. And I think your point, Jeff, though, is that he did take Hollywood liberties with that trial for dramatic purposes, obviously, to let the lawyers, you know, sort of cast some of these innuendo and things that that are obvious outside of the bounds of what would be allowed in a normal trial. So even with his legal background, still has to Hollywood up the story just a little bit.
Yeah. One other thing, you say it's a true story. There's a documentary on the Criterion Channel, and they went through the filming of it and how it was in town there. But apparently, just like in the movie, Mannion takes off with his wife in their caravan. Apparently, that happened, and with the original guy drove off just like in the movie, and left them without paying his lawyer's fee. I don't know what horror came of it, but you know, that little fact was
turnabout is fair play then, because Volker probably made back his law fee from this case, you know, tenfold between book sales and his screenplay rights. So, you know, justice was served for John Volker.
Okay. Well, thank you guys. That's very good. It's a true story. Hollywood eyes. That's very true also. All right. So let's go. Is White Fang, do we have another question for us? Does anyone know the exact name? This is from Mary. Does anyone know the exact name and location of the scene you showed at the beginning of the session? I remember my dad, who grew up in the UP, taking us there when the movie came out. Jeff, you've been up in the UP recently. Do you want to talk about that? That scene was in where Pie Eye. Do they have that? They do have that.
It's a little restaurant, and it looks exactly the same inside. I was just up there in October And the restaurant is, I don't know if it's still in Marquette County, but it's, as you're going from Marquette County over to Houghton, it's right on the highway there. And it's looking over a lake. It's a beautiful location. I'd recommend anybody go there just for the scenery and whatever. But they have pictures of all the cast members there: Jimmy Stewart, Duke Ellington, Lee Remick. Yeah, beautiful place, real place, and still looks exactly the same.
Usually, if you can go out, find the exact location by online. There's places that try to find films and their locations like this, and you might be able to find that on the internet more exactly. So you don't remember the name, Jeff.
I believe that Volker's house still stands, where it was Jimmy Stewart's office, still stands as it was in the movie today. You can still go in it, and they haven't changed it a bit.
And the courthouses were real too, and it shows also how just beautiful the courthouses, you know, with the amount of time and money that they put into building these structures. Just exquisite.
I just want to throw one thing in here before we, there's this scene where the two of them are eating hard boiled eggs at a counter, and behind them are the trains going by. And I seriously doubt if that stuff's there. And there's there we go. To my mind, this is one of the most, really a beautiful piece of cinema. And it really has nothing to do with anything except this wonderful little play that they're doing with, shelling the egg, and they're talking about the salt. And it's a real character study to show the closeness of these two people. But it has nothing to do with the plot, but it has everything to do with cinema, and especially with that stuff going on behind them. This is the kind of genius in this film that just the scene just drops in there. So you're talking about what makes this movie great. It's just a little scene like this, with them playing around with a hard-boiled egg, talking about salt, and there you have the UP in, with the trains and the
trains,
all that work. Just for that one scene.
The great thing about it is probably one of maybe 10,000 Hollywood films made during the 50s that would have shot on this shot on location, as opposed to just doing a rear projection shot with the two actors sitting in a soundstage somewhere. It's one of the many things that makes this film unique, is everything was on location. It just makes it more authentic.
Jeff, did you want to say something?
Yeah, that when I was up there, that I don't know if that very bridge is still in existence, but something just like it, where the railroad cars could actually go over the, you know, to the tankers and dump out their ore, is still there.
So I guess this is interesting. All of us had something to comment on it, because this scene reminded me of growing up when I was young. I'm old enough to remember going to bars in industrial areas, and you go in there at lunchtime or after work or even before work, and you could buy like for a nickel or a dime a beer. It wouldn't be in a glass bottle, it'd be a beer, and they'd have a bunch of eggs on the counter. And you can go and get eggs, and you can eat, maybe sometimes they have bread. Another place you go to, and people would, you know, when the whistle blew, you'd go, mass of people go to the bar and do this, and just like these guys are sharing and have a good chat with each other about what's going on, and then boop, they go back to work. So I thought that was really interesting. And Kevin, you're saying this is not a rear projection. I thought this was rear projection, but we don't want to debate that right now. But I mean, this is that was a real significant scene of camaraderie, like Ted was talking about.
Yeah, this still makes it look like rear projection, but when you're watching it, you know, in motion, it's definitely on location.
But if you want to talk about what cinema is and what it does as opposed to other arts, and that's the scene. You can't do that kind of thing in a book or a drama or anything like that. Something like that is pure cinema.
Yes.
The name of the restaurant, my wife just reminded me, is Mount Shasta, S-H-A-S-T-A in Mishigami.
So the name of the restaurant is Mount Shasta in Mishigami. So I hope that helps you get that. And you can always send us an email and we'll get that to you.
And of course, Duke Ellington still shows up and plays there like that's realism for you.
Okay. All right. Quite Fang, do we have another question for these guys? This is another one from Mayor Lee. Hi, Mayor Lee. How are you doing? An interesting sidelight is that Mayor Richard Daley of Chicago banned the movie in the city because of a sexual language, of the sexual language of the movie. He was a Catholic, and Premature went to court and had the ban reversed. Do you guys want to talk? Who would like to go on this? Ted, do you want to go on this first?
Well, the word panties. I think they love using that word over and over again. But there are other things like the rape and word the rape. Apparently, there was something about the definition of rape was penetration, and they didn't let them use. That was the one thing that Preminger changed. Violation. I guess they changed with violation. Yeah. But all that other language, the talk about rape and assault and, you know, the woman being beat up and all that was a big deal in those days. And like Kevin was talking about, partly Preminger believed in all this non-censorship stuff, but part of it was the showmanship too, as he knew he could get people in the theaters because television was taking on all the soapy, you know, the soap opera. So that was part of what happened there. And I think this was given, I don't know all the details of the background of this, but the language certainly was a big selling point. And, you know, you still laugh at the word panties and the way Joseph Welch pronounces that, you know. I'm going to say the word now, and I don't want another jitter in this whole courtroom when that word comes up.
Kevin?
Well, I was going to say that because Ted alluded to some of the rough language is how, while it's a murder trial, you could argue that the Lee Remick character, Laura, is really the one on trial during a good chunk of the testimony. When they first do the typical things in a rape case, which is, you know, was she asking for it? Was she too drunk to say no? Was she, baiting the rapist into action? So all of those were thrown out there by primarily Dancer, the DA from Lansing, but they took it even a step further in putting her on trial by bringing up her first marriage and how that marriage ended and how quickly her second marriage began, and, you know, painting her as this harlot with the scarlet A as a way of convicting her husband of his crime. And I think that, you know, it was somewhat uncomfortable to watch that with my wife and daughters, because quite often, even today, that's how a rape prosecution prosecution can turn and make the victim, called into question, their behavior called into question. So I think that, you know, that salacious language, certainly to Ted's point, did help Preminger promote the film, but I also think it was reflective of the time that it was necessary to push those boundaries, to bring up how horrible that is. And maybe it wasn't Preminger's direct point to try and bring up, you know, the hypocrisy of trying a woman when she's accused someone of rape. But it certainly is, salacious, to say the least. I mean, they called her an army slut. That was the most surprising word to me. That the censors let go was slut, which I had never heard in a movie that old. So,
but the thing about Lee Remick is she really loves that attention. There's just that beautiful scene where they say, well, we take off your hat and, you know, show what your hair is. And she proudly takes her hat off and swings her hair around.
Now, wait a minute, Ted.
Face. I mean, she really loves the men's attention. And that's a big part of her character, is the fact that she really loves men's attention and knows that she can get her way with them, even though it backfires on her for sure.
Let's draw the distinction, though. Laura loves that attention. Lee Remick's just a great actress who could make us believe.
Lee Remick is, she's one of my favorites.
Yeah. So, she's awesome in this movie. And Jeff, let's go back to the original question about this was abandoned by the mayor, and that Preminger went and filed suit, and he won the suit, and they were able to show it again. The question it becomes now is that, will they be able to show that, went to court and had the ban reversed, would that happen today? Is there any context? I mean, would the language in this film be banned, or could it be banned, or is there, as you said before, things have changed over time? Would this could be banned by a city or a township?
Oh my gosh, that is one thing that has changed. And what's so good about the judges nowadays is that they will take everything in context. It's not, when they were originally defining pornography, I mean, I'm sure you've all heard this, is that the Supreme Court justice says, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it. But it's like, if you have something in context, and anybody who's doing any kind of trial where there's language like this, and it has to come in. I mean, the juries are immersed in this very quickly, and you just get used to it. I mean, it's something that has to go. So courts are very good about allowing the First Amendment rights.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you very much. So White Fang, do we have another question for these guys? All right. Is there significance to the fishing lures Paul Begler makes during the trial? Do we have a fisherman among you? I don't think we do. Let's go to Kevin, you first. You haven't talked for us in a bit.
Well, I believe that Volker was also a fly fisherman as well. So I think I've never read the book, but I believe it's a part of his characterization in the book that he's just as dedicated to his fly fishing as he is to his legal work. So is there any significance to the specific flies that he's tying? I would say no. They don't actually seem that extraordinary, even in black and white, which minimizes some impact that the fly might have. But in and of themselves, I don't think there's significance beyond just that work play balance that that Begler had. I mean, his work is getting in the way of his enjoyment, which is fly fishing. So he's taking it into the courtroom. I also think it's sort of the folksy, small town lawyer, as he describes himself. It's just a business that he's doing for his performance. Everything's a performance. That's a little stage business that he's doing for the jury.
So Jeff, I see you're already there. Do you ever find that attorneys will do this type of stuff? There was also the judge up there winding his clock and doing different things on there. Do people do this, and does it affect how the trial goes?
My belief in the way Jimmy Stewart was doing this, and I've actually had an attorney that told me that he did this, is that he created a distraction. I mean, it's not about the fly fishing, it's anything like that. Is if there was something damaging that the other side was going into, you kind of do something distracting, like might take your pen apart and change the inkwell or something like that. And in this case, I mean, it was a great line leading up to it, where he gave the one fishing lure that was looking for bullfrogs to the judge, and then George C. Scott said, "We were caught on that," or whatever he said about saying, "Yeah, that was it was well played." This is basically what your paraphrase it was, but I think it was just a distraction. I don't think there's anything significant about the lures that I saw.
I'll put another thing out there. My wife's a knitter, and when she's in a group and she does knitting, and it seems like she's not paying any attention, but she says that's a way for her to concentrate and really pay attention to what's going on when she's doing the knitting. And there's some of that, I think, in what James Stewart's doing. There's another neat thing in the movie that James Stewart does. If you realize, he never lights his own cigarettes. He has these cigar things, but he never lights his own cigar. He always asks somebody to do it, or he borrows a lighter or something like that. And it's just another bit of his business in there. But it's kind of a neat little thing. That's the kind of thing that's going on in this movie that you really don't see at first. And then you realize that's just how he connects with people in a way. It's like, oh, you got a light,
Okay. All right. Do we have a next question? Oh, we got one from Peachy. Hi, Peachy. How are you doing? Any story behind the iconic key art, immediately recognizable after 60 years, very different from other theatrical posters of the era. Ted, do you want to talk about this one?
Well, it's Saul Bass, and he was revolutionized the opening credits, but it also he just was probably the best graphic designer of his day. And what it did was put a stamp on the movie that people would recognize right away. And like you say, after 60 years, it's still significant. But it just was, the word anatomy and the murder and the body parts and that kind of thing. I mean, it's really interesting that there's really not a whole lot about the murder itself in this movie. It's about the process of the trial and that kind of thing. I mean, nobody seems particularly upset that this fellow got murdered. And the only thing you see is a couple of photographs of him on the floor and that kind of thing. So the murder's not the big deal. But getting back to the graphics, I think that's part of what Preminger saw this genius of Saul Bass, who did some of Hitchcock's films too. And that way, people could really identify the movie. And another thing, I'll just throw this one out too, is Preminger used Duke Ellington's score, which was something very unusual at the time too, and added a lot to the film and made it unique. But at any rate, Kevin, you can talk more about this, I think.
No, I was just going to say that it sort of has a through line between Preminger's, I think it was 1955's The Man with the Golden Arm, who used, if you look at the body in Anatomy of a Murder's key art and zoomed in on the hand, there's a nice through line between those two films and connecting them. And Saul Bass did the titles for Man with the Golden Arm as well. So there is that, like I said at the top, with Preminger being independent, there is this, thing where he worked with the same people. And sort of drew connecting dots to between his films, and I think that's a perfect example of it. Saul Bass's work is incredibly iconic, and Peachy's right. They don't make posters like that anymore. They don't make title sequences like that anymore.
So I did have a lot of posters. That was a good question, Peachy, but we didn't have a lot of them. This is some of the posters. You go look at the posters of the movies. They're very creative like this way. But I also wanted to bring up, Preminger was also an actor. Many of us might remember him, but not know who he was. He also was I think it was Colonel in Stalag 17. Mm-hmm. And for all of us older ones that watched the original Batman television show, he was the first Mr. Freeze. So, yeah. Talk about art and iconic people, okay?
Another thing he did, which was revolutionary, was that he broke the blacklist. On the Exodus, he had Dalton Trumbo, that's his name, right, who was one of the Hollywood 10 who was blacklisted and went to jail. He actually put his name on the credits, and that was the beginning of the end for the blacklist, which is huge. That's a huge thing that Preminger was responsible for.
Okay, yeah. All right. Very good, guys. White Fang, do we have another question here? Oh, this one's Sylvain. And it was fun to see the bartender when he was young. He was so great in Jaws as the mayor. Oh, I don't have a... So, Jeff, you're laughing the most. Can you respond to this one?
Oh, no, that's part of the fun of seeing these old movies and seeing that, that's because I'm thinking of what a He was kind of the same role of Wormy in this movie and Wormy as the mayor in John. But nothing more. I just thought it was a very funny comment.
Kevin, you're unmuted there.
It was just Murray Hamilton is the guy's name, and it's he'll pop up in movies from the mid to late 50s through the 70s, and he's never a nice guy. He's just one of those, you nailed it, Jeff. He's just one of those sort of smarmy guys who's maybe doesn't tell the truth very often. At least isn't used to telling the truth.
Okay. Very good. Okay, thank you, White Fang. Duke Ellington wrote a non-conventional jazz score for the film. In what way is it different from other scores at that time? What effect does the score have in the film? Kevin, you're the only one unmuted.
No, I'm just not muting, so I'm sorry. First of all, Duke Ellington was the first African-American to score a Hollywood picture, so that's significant in and of itself. Preminger had Ellington and his band that included Billy Strayhorn, who's one of the great composers of the 40s and 50s. He had them stay on set the entire two-month shoot up in the UP. While he may not be performing at that bar very regularly, they were around the set the entire time. And I think the amazing thing about the score is its sparseness. The courtroom scene, I don't think, has any music under it. And it's really to punctuate events outside of the court. I think its sparseness is what is really great about it. A couple weeks ago, I think TCM showed this as one of the first films in a month-long series on jazz in the movies. And Eddie Muller, who hosts it, was talking to Ellington's granddaughter. And they both made the point of the sparseness of the music in this. Interesting thing about this is Ellington's score won the Grammy for Best Musical Score for a Film, but wasn't nominated for an Academy Award. And there's only been 5 films in the history of the Grammys and the Oscars where a Grammy winning score hasn't been nominated for an Oscar, this being the first of the 5. So great score, though.
Great score. It was very good. This is when we started this, it was really good to hear that jazz play, and I just think that was really good. And how they incorporated him into the movie was fantastic, because the score, as Kevin said, didn't play in the courtroom, but it played outside and had accenting comments throughout the film. Very good.
James Stewart could tickle the ivories too. I'm not sure. At the very end, he did not play that thing at the last scene. That was not his playing, but he could be playing along with Duke Ellington in that scene in the bar there. But he in college, he played in a jazz band.
Cool. I didn't know that.
One last piece on the music. That scene where Ellington and Jimmy Stewart are playing side by side at the piano forced the film to be banned in South Africa for more than a decade, because Preminger refused to remove it, and South Africa would not show films where a black man and a white man were sitting next to each other playing music or doing anything else. So Preminger stood by his guns, though, and would not allow them to cut that. And I think it's only a 15 or 20 second shot of the two of them next to each other, but he would not remove it.
Well, thank you for the information. All right, I think we have another question. We're getting down in time here. We've got about 7-8 minutes left. For this from Scott. Saw a blunder about 35 minutes in Jimmy Stewart's visit to the prosecutor, and the sign outside of his office says, prosecutor, attorney, fun to see. Did anybody notice that? I didn't.
It's the beauty of location shooting. There's not nearly enough eyes on every single detail of the frame as there would be on a Hollywood soundstage. But it's the beauty of location shooting.
That's very good. All right, I missed that. I want to go back and look for it.
I know, me too.
All right, White Fang. Another one here. Was Laura's character in the book as flirtatious as the character in the movie? Did anybody read the book? I didn't get a chance.
No.
No, we didn't. So what we're going to commission everybody who's listening is to go out and read the book now and answer all those questions. Because I want to go get the book now and read it myself. So I think that's pretty good. Sorry, we couldn't answer that one. And we haven't time for one more question from the Q&A or another one. I was a little confused. Are Laura and her husband scam artists skipping from town to town? That's a really good question. How would you, I see, and who would like to go first on this one here?
I just think they were army brats. I mean, that's their way of living. I mean, there are certain people I had some friends that were brought up in an Air Force family that moved every 2 years, and this young lady would always, every after 2 years, she didn't feel comfortable and had to move on to a new town. So that's their way of life, and that's part of the reason probably why they stuck together, was that they had that in common of being on the move all the time.
Jeff,
what I was going to say is I think there's a lot of incentive for them to leave town because I'm sure there's a lot of bad blood. But the thing is, they think of owing a few thousand dollars to somebody in the 1950s. That's a lot of money. I'm quite certain, separate apart from the movie, that there would have been a fee agreement that would have been signed beforehand. And if he takes off and he's not able to get served with a summons for the lawsuit, and you can't serve a summons on your client before the case is done, because that creates a conflict of interest, obviously. So, you know, he would have had to serve that. So if he skips town, today's money, maybe $30,000, $50,000, you know, something like that. So yeah, I think that's probably why he left.
So, well, thank you guys. This actually question leads in because we're down to 50, we're down to the last 3 or 4 minutes. And I'd like to ask one question from each of you. I'll put it up here real quick. This is the last question for tonight. We want to thank everybody for all the questions. We still got some more to go here, but this is the last question that we'll answer, and we'll do a little discussion at the end. If you were a juror, would you find Mannion guilty or not? Let's start with Ted.
Well, you know, I've actually been on a jury for a murder trial, and it's just amazing to be in the murder, being in the courtroom and then in the jury room. And it depends upon a lot how it was presented and how you would look at it. And from what I see in the movie and the way George C. Scott was, you're kind of judging the character of Mannion on George C. Scott goofing up at the end. So I would probably go with the jury and say, yeah, let's let him go. Because, you know, and the whole thing of reasonable doubt, but that didn't even come up in this thing.
All right. Kevin, what about you? We're all sitting watching this movie. The Preminger does a good job of having us look at the movie like we're all jurors, having to decide for ourselves. How would you decide?
I would think he's guilty because there's nothing that was... I don't think that it was proven of his diminished mental capacity. So I think the theatrics of the defense attorney, which are certainly not unique to this trial, I think he was guilty. Simple.
So Jeff, you do defending, and also you do, and you're applying to be the prosecutor. You're not applying; you're running for prosecutor. But we're all able as citizens to go up and serve on a jury, as Ted was bringing out. How would you, if you were sitting on a jury after watching this film, what would you do?
Well, and this goes back to the very first question that we had is, what's significant about this movie? And I was saying how real it is. What's also important is that you're basically able to see how the sausage is made. And, you know, so you're seeing everything behind the scenes and so much more than what the jury sees. So the jury sees a very small amount, and you know, the jury, as I showed up the jury instruction books, they're given a very limited instruction, and there's a really high burden on the prosecutor in this case. But given the fact that he may have had that feeling, there's always remedies. I'm not that big on vigilante justice, so I probably would find him guilty.
Okay. Well, thank you.
One thing, in this one murder trial, everybody in the jury room thought the guy was guilty, but it wasn't proven. So there was enough reasonable doubt that we had to let him go. It was an amazing experience to be part of that.
And I think this is one thing about this film and adding to the murder, as we've discussed. And Jeff, thank you much for being here today with your experience and everything else. And Ted, at the end, revealing that you've actually worked on a murder case. That's interesting. But the movie does bring you into, like Ted has said before, the aspect of the personalities and the courtroom drama and everything else. And it's focused on everybody walking away with their interpretation of what they think, and you get the chance to be the juror. So we're reaching our time to wrap up right now. I would like to just tell everyone it's Sylvain's birthday tomorrow.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. That's really good. And thank you for being here tonight. That's good. Hope you have a good day tomorrow. So we want to just let everybody know that next week our film, we're starting tomorrow. We'll have everything up on the webpage by tomorrow morning and everything available for you is Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. So that starts. That's a
also
classic.
With George C. Scott.
With George, it's also with George C. Scott. And it's interesting that you say that, Jeff. And so Jeff will be joining us next week as well because he's a fan of this movie. And I think we'll have a good time. So please go out this week. Look at our introduction. Kevin has posted an introduction already out there on our YouTube channel. Go look at that. And then also to then view the film on your streaming service of choice and come back and visit us next week. We want to thank you very much for joining us, and also to our volunteers tonight, Kevin, Ted, and Jeff, for thanking and helping us. And White Fang, thank you very much for all the work in the background that you've done. We appreciate that very much. You all have a good evening, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.
Thank you.